When we finish tonight, me and the lads, we've got 3.5 ton of gear to get out of here, out the side of the stage, which is going to be loaded into that big wagon outside. Now, when we finish, we're always hungry afterwards, right? But the only places you can get anything to eat late at night in most cities are Indian restaurants, right? Because the French places, the posh places, do not take kindly to the drunks coming in after the pubs have closed, smashed out of the brains, wobbling in, throwing up all over the other customers, dancing in the soup and fencing with the long French loaves. They do not like this. So, the only places you can get anything to eat are the Indian gaffs. Now, I'm having a meal one night in Bradford in a place called Saeed's Curry Corner on the Leeds Road going out. I tell you these pieces of information just in case anybody does not believe that this is a true story. Sitting down with a lad called Dave Brady eating, when in came Super Drunk. Now, Superman comes when anybody needs him. Super Drunk comes when no bugger wants him, right? Superman goes into telephone boxes and comes out chained. Super Drunk goes into Yates's Wine Lodge and comes out totally demented, right? He's been drinking draft kryptonite all night. He doesn't know whether he's on this earth or Fuller's. He's absolutely gone, right? He's walked into so many brick walls on the way down the street that his head has got a textured look. There's lines up and down it all over. It looks like he's talking out of a string bag, right? To cap it all and look really like Superman really looks, he's put his underpants on outside his trousers. And he sticks his head through the door of this cafe and comes out with this statement that makes us all ashamed to be English. He stuck his head through and went, "Hey, Sabu, come here." And we went, "Oh, God, no, he's here now. Oh, Super Drunk. Somebody's put the bat signal up in the sky. Oh." And this very polite waiter went over and said, "Yes, what can I do?" And he came up with this question. Can you believe this question? "Do you make curry in here?" That's like asking, can a duck swim or does a bear crap in the woods? What an amazing question. We're all sat round with yellow mouths and steam coming out of our ears. And so the waiter said, "Oh yes, making curry." So this bloke wobbles in, totally demented, wobbles in, flops down in a chair and starts the heavy breathing through the nose, glaring at everybody, but you know, hey, Sabu, come here, Sabu, come here, come here. Yeah, I want to see the menu, never mind the menu. Give us one of them right hot curry there, kid. Give us one of them right hot bum burners, the nose, eh? One of them right hot ring singers, the nose, what I mean. I have a needle job, right? Right? King prawn vindaloo off the bone, right? One of them Gandhi's revenges, right? And Zithi, Sabu, come here, Zithi, I don't want no rice and no chips, right? No rice and no chips. Just give us 14 chapatis. I don't know if you know what chapatis are. They're huge bread pancakes, 2 foot across, 1/2 inch thick. You can live on one for a fortnight, right? So the waiter, surprisingly, said, like, you know, 14 chapatis. He said, "Aye, sup some ale to eat, the nose. Sup some stuff, me and the lads. 17 pints, the nose. Man, I was paralytic, the nose, eh? Hey, the nose, see the. I don't know where lads have got to, the nose. They jumped over a wall to have a pee. I think it was a railway bridge." Last I saw of them, they were waving off coal wagons going to Pontefract. Hey, and Sabu, come here, kid, come here, see the nose. Give us 20 papadums while I'm waiting, eh? 20 papadums are the big crisps, right? Foot and a half across. So we get 20 papadums, whatever, king prawn, vindaloo off the bone, and 14 chapatis. Yes, okay, goes off. Now, Super Drunk then takes out a packet of fags. Now, they must give these drunks joke packets of fags. They've got to be joke packets of fags. Because he opens them up and they go all over the restaurant. Bling! People's air, people's dinners. There's 6 in the water jug they've unravelled. It's like brown Windsor soup. Just... And he And he tries to light one of these fags that he finds on the floor, a broken one that somebody's trod on. It's cracked down the middle, so he's sucking air through the crack. And there's nothing happening at the end he's supposed to be lighting. He's got 18 inches of flame. He's burning all the air off his headlights. It's all just going. And his plastic on his glasses is smouldering away. The lenses have just dropped out. They've gone. And he suddenly catches sight of us watching him, because by now, we've stopped eating. We're watching the cabaret. We're enjoying it every minute. It's delightful. And he's what sees us, like, because we're all stood around, and he goes, starts breathing through the nose and abusing us, you know, going, and you have fun, you have fun. And he has a glass of this tobacco juice, like, you know, the, and it gives him hiccups right away, so he's going, and you have fun, and you have fun, and you have fun, and you have fun. And people are getting up to dance to it. They're doing the conga out of the door. And you found it. And you found it. The waiter brings in the pappadoms. You know these crisps, right? He puts the pappadoms down on the table. This bloke sees 11 piles of pappadoms, right? He's going, eeny, meeny, by the ball. And he gets the right one and smashes it into smithereens with one blow of his fist. Pappadom shrapnel flies all over the cabin. People are led out with severe lacerations from flying pappadoms embedded in the walls. In the meantime, the waiter has gone in the kitchen and has said to the chef, there is outside in the kitchen one esteemed English bullock. Pleased to be giving him plenty of capnair, but give him the works, because the chef must have put everything in it. Sloan's liniment, fiery jack, nitromores, poly stripper, mustard powder, an oxo cube to give it a bit of flavour, and 17 tubes of deep heat. Because the waiter has to bring it in with asbestos gloves and a welding mask. And he brings it in, mushroom-shaped clouds coming off it, barbed wire all around it. He puts it down. And then he comes in with 14 chapatis, like 200 weight of hot towels. This bloke takes one of these, folds it up. Now, fair play to him, he had a go, right? He folds it up, dips it in the curry. The curry eats it. So he gets another one. Gone. It has ate before it's satisfied. And it's lying there with an evil grin on its face. Just going, I dare you. I bloody dare you. Go on. So he gets his ninth one, like, folds it up, dips it in. Nothing happens. He thinks, I'm all right. He gets a big lump of this king prawn vindaloo off the bone and a big dollop of curry sauce, puts it in his mouth and bites on it. Now, from then on, everything goes into slow motion. His face registers no change of expression whatsoever, but his body goes into deep trauma. Right? His ears actually try to get off his head. His eyebrows end up on the cheeks of his bum. Every pore in his body opens and he starts to rain. We're watching with menus held over our heads, you know. And he still carries on. He's so far drunk that his brain actually opens a door in the side of his head and goes off. You're flying solo now, pal. What? And he carries on eating. He's so gone, he just carries on. You know what these drunks are like. He doesn't know what's happening to him. He's anaesthetised by the booze. His brain don't feel it. His body's going, ah! Trouser legs going up and down like roller blinds, you know. So he's got the chapati, like, in his hand. And he's eating it. And he gets his handkerchief out of his top pocket. Dips his chapati, eats it. Mops his head with his hanky. Dips his chapati, eats it. Mops his head with his hanky. Dips his hanky, eats it, mops his head with a chapati. in Bradford in 1974, I actually watched a bloke eat his handkerchief. Honest to God, he was chewing it and chewing it, drinking tobacco juice with it, and hiccuping and abusing everybody, and the bloody tough bugger this is. Tough bugger this, bloody. But he chewed it and swallowed it. Stuck the chapati in his top pocket and wobbled off into the night. Abusing everybody. He left my life, that bloke. Left my life forever, apart from in my imagination. Because I imagine what happened when this bloke woke up the next morning. He's lying in bed there, his wife's sat up in bed next to him, waiting for him to come round. He comes together very slowly, not feeling at all well. His mouth feels as though a regiment of Gurkhas have slept in it all night. And he's coming on, giving it the, Oh, hello, love. Don't you bloody hello me. You animal. Oh, what do you mean? You bloody animal. What do you mean? Shut up. I don't know what you were eating last night, but your breath has singed all the bloody pillow. Look at the state of it. You burnt all the varnish off the bed end. I've had to get up four times in the night to put the bloody wallpaper out. And by heck, are your guts bad? You've had the duvet across the room 17 times. You've had the ships answering back from Salford Docks. They've launched the Morecambe lifeboat twice. And the 16 factories round here clocked off 4 hours early. You let one rippets crack the wardrobe door. And there's something rolled downstairs, the dog took one look at it and ran out the house. You're a bloody animal. Oh, I don't feel well, love. I tell you what, love, I'm going to get up and I'm going to the bathroom, love. I shall be there 3 or 4 hours, I think. I'll take the hot water bottle with me to bite on, right? While I've gone, put some toilet paper in the fridge for us, will you? While I've gone. I